Beijing slamming Manila following the creation of the Philippines' National Maritime Council, which will lead efforts to safeguard the country's waters. Former Duterte spokesperson Harry Roque claims the former president's China policy is better than that of the Marcos administration. Cebu City now experiencing a water crisis due to the El Niño phenomenon. And more schools suspend in-person classes due to sweltering conditions in parts of the country. We'll tackle this with the deputy spokesperson of the Education Department, Assistant Secretary Francis Bringas. Hi, I'm Pravina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, nice to have you with us today. Topping the midday news, China lashing out at the Philippines as it again accuses Manila of reneging on its supposed promises in the South China Sea. See, Beijing's foreign ministry claims Manila continues to make provocations in the South China Sea by relying on support from what it called external forces. It also slammed the Philippines for allegedly violating a memorandum of understanding on properly managing maritime tensions and the declaration of the conduct or on the conduct of parties in the South China Sea.
The Philippines, backed by external forces, has been going back on its words and making provocations. This is the real cause of the current tensions at sea. Nothing will hide the truth. And no one should turn black into white. The Philippines needs to immediately stop violating China's sovereignty and its provocations and return to observing the spirit of the DOC. China will not waver in its resolve to safeguard its territorial sovereignty and maritime rights and interests.
China's ire follows the creation of a National Maritime Council under the Marcos administration. Despite Beijing's remarks, the National Security Council says the Philippines will exhaust all diplomatic measures to resolve tensions in the West Philippine Sea.
Marami sa ating mga kababayan, akala nila yung counter-response natin or measures natin ay purely military. Hindi po, no? The measures cover multi-dimensions. And this is one aspect of that. Madalas dahak, nakafocus lang tayo sa West Philippine Sea. Ngunit meron pa tayo mga ibang challenges. For example, yung sa Benham Rise, nasa east side ng ating bansa. Nasa north side natin, sa Batanes, no? Sa south, yung facing Indonesia and Malaysia. So lahat po ng lugar na yan requires maritime domain awareness.
Meanwhile, the president's sister, Senator Aimee Marcos, opposes the creation of the National Maritime Council. For her, the measure attracts what she called Trojan horses of foreign interference through donations, grants, and gifts, which the council has been authorized to accept. Senator Marcos also says emotion rather than reason has prevailed in Manila's maritime dispute with Beijing, and it could lead to what she called a dangerous path. She adds any action that may put Filipinos in danger is gross irresponsibility. A former spokesperson of Rodrigo Duterte says the former president never entered into a so-called gentleman's agreement with China over a Union Shoal. Attorney Salvador Panelo says he talked to Duterte about it and he denied forging a deal with China. Panelo adds whoever made that claim only wants publicity. It was another former Duterte spokesman, attorney Harry Roque, who revealed the deal. Roque said Panelo is correct because the agreement was not specific to a Union Shoal.
The gentleman's agreement is to respect the status quo on the entire West Philippine Sea dispute. So that is correct. I do not deny that. And that is why I am, in fact, surprised that what has been coming out in the media is a sellout of sorts.
Meanwhile, Attorney Roque believes the Philippines would lose a Union Shoal if it keeps a hardline stance against China. He's claiming the Marcos administration's policy on China is leading nowhere, given Beijing's continuing aggression. For Roque, the Duterte administration had the better foreign policy, claiming it was able to maintain BRP Sierra Madre without attracting China's attention.
We now find a situation where we have clearly treated China not even as a friend, but perhaps as an enemy, which to me will not bode well for the country. The better option is the option opted by President Duterte. Let's proceed with matters that we could proceed on, matters like trade and investments, and set aside these disputes for the time being. If we persist in what we're doing, China will just bar us from a union altogether. And, you know, mark my word, I said it in your program. If we continue with this course of action, we will be forced to retrieve our soldiers because they will starve to death.
Roque now says the Philippine government could decommission the BRP Sierra Madre, the country's lone Navy outpost in the West Philippine Sea, to ease tensions.
Make it into a Coast Guard vessel so that it will not be a militarized vessel. And therefore, if we decommission it, then perhaps China will allow it to be repaired. Now, I do not know if China will or will not, but certainly that will make us conform with UNCLOS. Coast Guard is considered a civil vessel, and it could also be armed for all intents and purposes.
A former Philippine senator meanwhile warns the public against falling for Roque's remarks. For Antonio Trillanes, Roque's warning that the Philippines would lose Ayungin Shoal only supports China's narrative.
That's fear-mongering. And I think that's the narrative that China wants to spread. No? And it's ironic that Filipinos are spreading that Chinese propaganda. Hindi lang si Harry Roque, si Duterte mismo, no? During the Duterte administration, ganun sila. Ano sinabi ni Duterte? Gawin nyo na lang Philippine province of China.
Trillanes adds, decommissioning the BRP Sierra Madre would be a huge mistake.
That's a trap. Okay, and that's what China wants. Okay, remember, kaya hindi ginagalaw yung BRP Sierra Madre. Kahit theoretically, kayang-kayang i-overrun ng PLA yan, ng Chinese Armed Forces. But since a commissioned ship siya ng Philippine Navy, it may trigger the Mutual Defense Treaty. So the moment you decommission that, then it's now vulnerable. No? Pwede na silang iharas ng iharas until mag-alisan yan.
The Philippine Coast Guard regains full access to its official Facebook page today, Tuesday. See, an unknown entity had hacked the PCG's Facebook page last week, posting violent content. This prompted Coast Guard officials to conduct back-end operations and assess the security breach. The PCG's website was among several government websites that were hacked February in a cyber attack traced to a telecom company based in China. Well, in other news, Cebu City now experiencing a water crisis as it struggles to counter the effects of the El Nino weather phenomenon. Our very own Annie Perez now joins us with details. Annie, how are things from your end?
Yes, Carmina, that's right. Cebu City Mayor Rama, Michael Rama, made a declaration that the city is under a state of water crisis. This came after the city council also declared 28 mountain barangays to be under a state of calamity due to the ill effects of the El Nino phenomenon. Rama said that this is already an emergency. Within the water crisis, Rama explained that he will convene a team to look into untapped water resources. Part of the team's response is to create piping, impounding, and the erection of a dam. He said that there are still sources in the areas of Barangays Buo, Tagbao, among others. Rama will use logic and practical approaches, as he said, to this situation. They're also eyeing to provide bottles of potable water to residents in these mountain villages. Water tankers will also continue to supply water to these areas for the meantime. Photos obtained by the city showed that most of the water sources of farmers in these mountain villages have already dried up. Cracks on the ground are already visible, while crops have died due to the intense heat. Residents in these areas also scamper to wait for water ration from water trucks provided by the city. The Department of Veterinary Medicine and Fisheries also showed photos of farm animals being dehydrated. Aside from the members of the Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office, Mayor Rama will convene with key officials of the Metro Cebu Water District and other experts in water sourcing from the academe. Cebu's heat index has reached 38 degrees Celsius yesterday and expected to increase today to 39 degrees Celsius, said Pag-asa Visayas in its latest forecast. Residents are advised to stay indoors, hydrate, and limit physical activities to prevent heat stroke and other illnesses. And that's the latest here from Cebu. Annie Perez, ABS-CBN News.
Thanks a lot, Annie Perez. They're joining us on the line. And back here in the newsroom, the Philippine Energy Department assures the public of adequate power supply despite the onset of the dry season and the ongoing El Nino phenomenon. The DOE says Luzon still has 2,000 megawatts to spare, while Visayas and Mindanao are still 200 megawatts away from their estimated peak demand. This was a reversal of the agency's earlier statement statement that the Luzon grid may face yellow alerts in April and May as falling water levels in dams reduce power supplies from hydroelectric plants. The department estimates demand for power may peak either in May or June. More schools suspending in-person classes due to extreme heat. Several local government units in at least seven regions have shifted to alternative mode of teaching as temperatures reach dangerous levels in some areas. These include parts of Negros Occidental, Pangasinan, South Cotabato, and even here in Metro Manila. Despite this, the Education Department asserts class suspensions due to the hot weather will not cause a learning disruption. Despite the searing heat, the Davao Regional Athletic Association pushed through with its regional tournament. But Vice President in Education Sara Duterte reminded game officials to pause the competition if it gets too hot. Hernel Tocco now joins us with that story. Hernel, what more can you tell us?
Carmina, good afternoon. The athletes of the Davao Regional Athletic Association who were participating in the 2024 athletic meet marched while the performers danced under the scorching sun at the Davao City UP Mindanao Sports Complex on Monday afternoon. The Davao City Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Office recorded the highest heat index in the city yesterday at 39 degrees Celsius at 2 p.m. or in caution level. In her speech, Vice President and Education Secretary Sara Duterte reminded coaches and game officials that they can halt the game in the event of intense heat. She said that if the weather is too hot or the sun is still, they can stop the game or they can choose to play in the early morning or late afternoon. Department of Education Region 11 spokesperson Dodong Atilio said that as much as possible, they will avoid holding outdoor sports events from 10 o'clock in the morning up to 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Duterte also reminded the athletes to observe their condition during the games by not hesitating to ask for a timeout or ask for a substitution if they feel that they can't take the heat anymore or they do not feel well. Vice Mayor J. Melcher Quetain also reminded the athletes to stay hydrated as the local government monitors the heat index of the city in the next few days. After the Davra meet opening, Atilio said there was no reported untoward incidents such as fainting due to the weather. Meanwhile, Duterte also said that schools can switch into blended learning amid the rising heat index in the country due to the El Niño phenomenon. Duterte said there is no problem with the local government unit suspending classes as schools can implement blended learning or distance learning. The vice president also said that despite the absence of full in-person classes, the students' learning still continues through the use of modules. Reporting from Davao City, Hernel Tocmo, ABS-CBN News.
Thanks a lot, Hernel Tocmo. They're joining us on the line. And back here in the newsroom, we'll be speaking now with the Assistant Secretary for Operations and Deputy Spokesperson of the Education Department, Francis Bringas. Assistant Secretary, good afternoon to you. Thanks for taking our call and welcome to the program.
Yeah, thank you so much and good afternoon to all your listeners and fellow viewers.
All right, how are the schools dealing with the extreme heat that even here in Metro Manila we're experiencing and all over the country as well? What are the latest reports coming from the ground, Assistant Secretary?
Yeah, we are experiencing extreme heat, particularly in the Western Visayas, where majority, if not all of our school division offices have shifted to alternative delivery mode. Just today, this morning, the Quezon City, the school division office of Quezon City, also declared a suspension of face-to-face classes. And also, we have one in the Lupan City and a couple of municipalities in South Cotabato. And definitely, this is based on an executive order that was issued by the local chief executive. Although we are, again, reiterating that in the absence of executive orders from the LGU, the school head are actually authorized to exercise their wide discretion on suspending classes due to extreme heat.
Yeah, and we know that you have given as a school some sort of an autonomy when it comes to these things. But upon your observation, Assistant Secretary, are all the schools shift capable despite our distance now from the pandemic that had happened? Are the schools able to do that still, and are they still well equipped to be shift capable if the need arises?
I guess they are. From the experience of the 2 years of not having face-to-face classes all over the country in the public and the private schools, I think all our teachers are now very experienced on the fault to go to alternative delivery mode whenever there are disruptions like this. Our self-learning modules and our textbooks are still very much available for our learners to use, particularly in the areas where internet connectivity is not that stable, where online classes is not also possible. So we are assuring our schools, our learners in the schools affected by incident or suspensions, that their learning will continue. And then, of course, when they go back after the suspensions, they can still have time to cope with the new competencies because of the suspension.
Mm-hmm. Assistant Secretary, when you say, I guess, and you, I think, are these just based on assumptions that you think and you guess that they can or still are shift capable, or is this based on actual ocular inspections and assessment on the ground that they are still shift capable?
Well, because this shift to alternative delivery mode is just happening like a week after, before the Holy Week in Western Visayas, and then again in Western Visayas, mainly after the Holy Week, we will have to get official reports coming from the regional offices and other field offices on the actual occurrences or actual scenario in the schools where there are suspensions, so that we will see where there may be some need for technical assistance for these particular schools in the shifting from face-to-face to alternative delivery mode.
Are you about to order that, or is that ongoing?
Well, that is an ongoing, and that is an innate function of the regional offices as well as our school division offices. So they will be coming up with their reports submitted to the central office after, in a few weeks' time or next week, they will be able to submit a monitoring report.
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing, Assistant Secretary, this is not going to be the last season wherein we're going to experience extreme heat or for that matter, extreme weather conditions. What is the plan of the Education Department insofar as future-proofing our schools and our learners?
Well, perhaps our move to shorten the current school year and closing the current school year 2 weeks earlier and then gradually shifting to a June to March traditional school year, it's probably a good move this year to be able to move it to an earlier closing so that we can actually go to a June opening by 2026-2027 school year. But we are still looking at possibilities through consultations again, whether we can still push for an even earlier than a third week of June opening by 2026, so that our shift to the June to March traditional school year would happen in a faster way.
Yeah, but as a secretary, what about climate change? I mean, you can move the school calendar wherever you want throughout the year, but when it comes to climate change, there's no telling when extreme weather conditions will happen. When you talk about future proof, what about retrofitting classrooms, for example, building them better?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Right. Right, we do have that. We now have new designs of climate resilient classrooms that we are talking about. We are in consultation with the Department of Education as well as the DOSB. And then we have this ITSR, that is a program with the World Bank on the pilot schools and pilot regions for the building of a climate resilient new designs for classrooms. And that is the direction of our school infrastructure and facilities trend, on finding ways by which we can redesign our classrooms so that they are resilient to climate weather conditions.
Mm-hmm. Is that a hard target that the Education Department has set, that at the end of your term that we will be able to see a number of these climate resilient classrooms all over the country, Assistant Secretary?
Well, this World Bank funded program on classroom resilient classrooms are actually for implementation by this school year up to the second, by this year up to the up to 2025. Mm-hmm. So we will be looking at the new designs of climate resilient classrooms by the end of 2025, and hopefully this will be the new design that will be used by the department in its regular school building programs from the GAA allocations for capital outlay.
And how many classrooms are we looking at here, and Assistant Secretary?
Well, I don't have the numbers now as well as the amount, but this is in millions of dollars that is distributed over several regions, in all the 16 regions in identified schools. And actually the project with the World Bank is actually being endorsed by our regional development councils of all the 16 regional development councils, including that of the farm. So once this will get the clearance from an endorsement from the RDCs, this will be the last part of its preparation for its implementation with the World Bank.
And are these classrooms that we're talking about, are these classrooms brand new classrooms, meaning it will eat up into the backlog of classrooms, or are these existing classrooms that are just being retrofitted?
Well, these are different stages, actually. One, we have classrooms that are for retrofitting, we have for repair, and we have projects for new construction. But these are not part of the regular school building program that we have in the department, but the recipients of this program with the World Bank would be a basis for non-inclusion already in the regular school building program, so that we have leeway to use this fund for the regular school building program to other schools that are qualified for additional classrooms.
Let's talk about the protocols for suspending in-person classes in case the weather becomes too hot. Could you run us by the protocols that the Department of Education has regarding these suspension of in-person classes?
Okay, so primarily we are looking at the forecast coming from the DOST Pagasa. Mm-hmm. Yeah, DOST Pagasa, and it usually comes in a weekly forecast. So based on the heat index that is 41 and above, that's already a dangerous heat index as per Pagasa, and that is the threshold by which our school heads can actually declare suspension of face-to-face classes in the area in the absence of an executive order. And in that event, our automatic shift to ADM will happen, and then it will cover days, perhaps in the number of days that are based on the forecast. So it may go up to 1 to 2 days, or up to a week, or even up to more than a week, depending on the available forecast from the DOST. Mm-hmm. But we are also looking at some areas which are not covered, or are not beyond the scope of the heat indices that is released by the PAGASA. Then we rely on the wide discretion of our school heads whether to suspend or not the face-to-face classes, but these have a repertorial requirement to the SDOs as well as the regional offices and the central office, so that we can also monitor these schools who are suspending their classes. Mm-hmm.
And based on your coordination with PAGASA, DOSD as well, have you reached the peak? Is this the peak week, or are you looking at possibly an extended scenario of the situation that we have now in the coming weeks, Assistant Secretary?
Based on the PAGASA forecast, we are looking at April up to May, which is the occurrence of heat waves in most parts of the country. So we are anticipating that, and we already have our DRRMS that has coordinated with its field counterparts in the schools, division offices and districts and regional offices, so that they may prepare already their intervention plan and mitigations whenever these things happen in their area.
All right. We'd like to thank you for taking our call. Assistant Secretary Francis Bringas there, Deputy Spokesperson of the Education Department. Really appreciate you taking our call.
Thank you so much.
Right from there, we're going to take a quick break. Up ahead, two contractors facing fines after failing to finish roadworks along EDSA during the Holy Week break, causing heavy traffic. Details when we return. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ABC. Back with more news. Two private contractors of a giant telecommunications firm facing fines for failing to finish roadworks on EDSA after the Holy Week break. Globe Telecom's private contractors, HGC Global Communications and R-Link Corporation, are working on the underground installation of fiber optic cable along the southbound portion of EDSA. But the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority says they failed to comply with the agency's condition that roadworks should have been cleared by Monday, April 1st. This has caused further congestion on one of Metro Manila's busiest roads, which the MMDA expects will last until the end of the week.
Yung epekto po nitong kalokohan nitong mga contractors na ito na nag-iwan po ng bukay sa EDSA ay hindi lamang po naman Lunes lang yung epekto. Mararamdaman pa rin po natin yan 2 to 3 days. Dahil po yung pagbubuhos po ng semento dyan will take a day or 2 to cure. Yun pong 40 po kasi ang nahukay na kanilang ginawa nitong dalawang contractors na to, 16 na natapos. Yung 16 daw po na yun ay hindi maayos yung pagkaka-restore ng simento.
Substandard.
Kailangan din po daw alisin. Uulitin po. For sure po, itong week na to po will be, you will experience talaga po heavy traffic hanggat po maayos po ng tuluyan.
The two firms will be slapped with a 50,000 peso fine per digging per day. The MMDA is also studying the possibility of banning the two from applying for excavation permits in the future. The overseas deployment of Filipino nurses continues its upward trend with the number of rehires and new hires more than doubling in 2023. Overseas deployment of nursing professionals reached over 81,000 in 2023 compared to just 38,000 the year before. The trend is expected to continue as more than 15,000 Filipino nurses have already been deployed in the first 2 months of 2024 alone. Meanwhile, a U.S.-based nurse staffing and recruiting firm initiated its own scholarship program for Filipino nursing students entering the last year of their course. Avant Healthcare says Filipino nurses with at least a year of practice have an opportunity to work in the U.S., which is suffering from staffing shortage.
That gap can range anywhere from a couple hundred thousand to well over a million nurses needed in the U.S. over the next 5 to 6 years. That's a huge gap to fill. There are no strings attached to the scholarship, and we do not require recipients to commit to working for Avant post-graduation. Our goal is simply to make a meaningful contribution to the advancement of nursing in the Philippines.
Japan is a top leisure travel destination for Filipinos. That's according to a study by Visa, which found 32% of Filipino travelers visited Japan in the past year. It is followed by Singapore, Hong Kong, and Thailand. The same study found 65% of the respondents are planning overseas leisure travel in the next 12 months, with Japan once again on the top of their list. Boutique airline Sunlight Air finds a new hub in the Clark International Airport. The Pampanga Airport says the move can help boost passenger traffic in its terminal. Jackie Pascual reports.
Boutique carrier Sunlight Air is now calling Clark International Airport its new home after transferring its hub from Manila to Pampanga. A ceremonial ribbon cutting and cake slicing event were done to mark the milestone. Its inaugural flight out of Clark was launched Monday, as the airline plans to connect the area to Coron, Siargao, Katiklan, and San Vicente.
It's a lot more spacious. They have innovative approach into doing things also. They have the self-check-in kiosk. They have the baggage drop.
The shift does not come cheap, says Brito Garcia, as operational expenses now are higher. But, she says, passenger comfort is priority and airfare will remain as is.
Our price points are usually the lowest among all of us. Even if that means tumaas yung operating expenses namin or yung direct cost ng airline, then we'd still go ahead with that decision just to be able to give our passengers the customer service that we envision for them.
She, however, clarifies they are not leaving Ninoy Aquino International Airport just yet, as they will still have a Manila-Cebu flight, its only flight out of Naiya. Meanwhile, plans are underway to expand its Clark hub, possibly buying or leasing two additional planes in the next 2 to 3 years.
The arrival of Sunlight Air at the Clark International Airport marks a milestone for the airport, which is still struggling to increase its number of passengers despite the rising travel demand.
Clark International Airport managed to hit nearly 2 million passengers in 2023, still below the 4 million pre-pandemic. Clark's private operator, Luzon International Premier Airport Development Corporation, or LIPAD, set an initial target of over 3 million passengers for this year, but they lowered it now to 2.4 million.
The issues of the engines, no, yung availability ng MRO, so we had to recalibrate the projections for this year. Yung realities kasi ng issues ng mga MRO sa mga airlines, no, that's actually the biggest, single biggest factor that's affecting the speed of recovery.
Mananquil now plans to make Clark the logistics hub in the region, since commercial airlines may still be having issues with spare parts. But he remains optimistic Clark will still attract more airlines, beginning with Sunlight Air this year, and will soon be followed by at least two more in the coming months.
With the support of BCDA, for certain minimum requirements, we've actually incentivized some of the flight-related charges. So it's also one of the way that we are encouraging the airlines to try to look at Clark.
He is also not worried with the upcoming rehabilitation of NAIA and the construction of the nearby Bulacan Airport, asserting that Clark has its own unique catchment area. The new terminal of Clark can accommodate 8 million passengers, but it is only fitted for 4 million. Mananquil asserts, once demand rises again, they can easily serve more people. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
World News now. Israel accused of a deadly attack on Iran's consulate in the Syrian capital, Damascus. Syrian state media says at least 6 people were killed and several more were injured in that airstrike. Iranian state media meanwhile said one of the fatalities was a senior commander of Iran's Revolutionary Guard, who is believed to be the target of the attack. Iran's ambassador to Syria vowing to respond to the deadly airstrike. Israel, which has repeatedly hit Iranian targets during the 6-month war in Gaza, has declined to comment on the reports. In Tehran, Iranian protesters burned Israeli and American flags as they gathered to condemn the attack. Israeli forces leave the Al-Shifa hospital in Gaza City after a 2-week operation. Israel says it killed or detained hundreds of Hamas militants and seized weaponry and intelligence documents. It adds it made sure to prevent harm to civilians, patients, and staff.
I believe that the terrorist takeover of Shifa and the subsequent special forces operation to clear the hospital of terrorists will be studied by future generations of military strategists at West Point and Sandhurst as the gold standard for urban warfare. The Prime Minister confirmed, and I quote, "Our forces operated there in an exemplary fashion. Shifa has become a main terrorism command center for Hamas. The surprise action by our forces was precise and surgical."
Palestinian officials meanwhile call the raid on Al-Shifa a war crime. Hamas and medics have denied any armed presence in Gaza's hospitals. Japan lifts its pause on funding to the UN Agency for Palestinian Refugees. Japanese Foreign Minister Yoko Kamikawa confirmed the funding resumption Tuesday after meeting with the UNRWA chief Philippe Lazzarini last week. The two officials discussed how the UN agency can strengthen its transparency and governance. The European Commission, Canada, Australia, Sweden, and Finland have also lifted their funding pause in recent weeks. The funding halt came after Israel alleged 12 of the agency's staff participated in Hamas's October 7 attack in southern Israel. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu vows to shutter the local office of Qatari news station Al Jazeera. This comes after the Israeli government make that Israeli parliament approved a bill allowing the temporary closure of foreign broadcasters considered to be a threat to national security. Al Jazeera, which has been fiercely critical of the military operation in Gaza, calls accusations it has harmed Israel's security a dangerous and ridiculous lie. The White House, meanwhile, expresses concerns over Israel's move.
If it is true, a move like this is concerning. We believe in the freedom of the press. It is critical. It is critically important, and the United States supports the critically important work journalists around the world do. And that includes those who are reporting in the conflict in Gaza.
South Korea's military says North Korea has fired a ballistic missile off its east coast. Japan also confirming the launch, with its Coast Guard urging vessels to be vigilant and to report any falling objects. This was the third ballistic missile launched from North Korea this year. Pyongyang has continued to develop its military arsenal despite strict international sanctions imposed over its nuclear weapons program. A temporary channel has opened in the U.S. state of Maryland for emergency vessels responding to the bridge collapse in Baltimore. Governor Wes Moore said the temporary channel will be allowed a limited number of tugboats and barges to get to the container ship stuck in the Patapsco River. Traffic leading to the Port of Baltimore, one of the busiest on the eastern seaboard, has been closed since Tuesday last week after the cargo ship struck the bridge, causing it to fall into the river. U.S. President Joe Biden will be traveling to Baltimore Friday to meet with local officials as he surveys the damage.
The president is continuing to lead a whole-of-government approach to the collapse. President Biden and his team are working with Governor Moore, the congressional delegation, Mayor Scott, and numerous state and local officials to reopen the port, rebuild the bridge, and support the people of Baltimore.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump posed a $175 million bond in his New York civil fraud case. The bond payment prevents state authorities from seizing Trump's assets, including the Trump Tower and his Mar-a-Lago estate in Florida. Trump is accused of fraudulently inflating his net worth by billions to secure better loan and insurance terms. Trump has denied any wrongdoing, insisting the case is a political witch hunt. Well, switching gears now, the story of Filipino-American labor leader Larry Itliong now being told as a musical. Let's take a look.
The story of famed Filipino-American labor leader Larry Itliong is told through song and dance in Larry the Musical. He's known to have organized and led protests in the 1930s for equal pay and dignified living conditions for farm and cannery workers throughout the West Coast and Alaska, up until the formation of the United Farm Workers in 1966. The musical is based on the book Journey for Justice, The Life of Larry Itliong, by the late Dr. Don Mabalon and by Gail Roman Santa, who is a writer and the executive producer of Larry the Musical.
What you see here are artists. What you're going to see is dance. You're going to see choreography. You're going to see singing. Filipinos love to sing. We have such amazingly talented singers. You're going to see script. You're going to see movement. And so that really, those tangible things that we can see ourselves and really feel the history, that we've never been able to just sit back and see the history in all of its joy, because our people are super funny and resilient.
Larry the Musical features a wide range of Phil-Am talent. Its actors say this is a unique experience to play a role that represents their culture.
I really feel that it is a privilege and honor to be part of something that is written by Filipino-Americans, specifically a female writing this material. When I'm acting on that stage, I feel like I've never played a part like this before. You know, I get to play myself. I get to play my mom, my titas, you know. It's rare.
I hope that it becomes a catalyst for more Filipino Americans to be on stage and shine and tell their own story and feel comfortable in a role that was actually written for them rather than a role that they're trying to fit into.
The cast and crew behind Larry the Musical hope that this performance will not only entertain but also educate the audience behind what some may say are the overlooked contributions of Phil-Ams in the historic fight for labor rights in the U.S.
I think when people walk out, I want for them to know that it's important to remember our history, to pass it down, you know, to future generations, because it doesn't end with us. It continues on.
I think if I want the audience to take away anything from the show, it's to fight for the things that you believe in, especially after everything that Larry did. Even though he was barely talked about, it was still such an important thing to do because he knew it was bigger than just himself.
Itliong was a fierce political union strategist, leading the Delano grape strike in the 1960s, teaming up with Cesar Chavez and Dolores Huerta and other Mexican farm workers. He passed away in 1977, and Larry the Musical is the latest example of keeping his legacy alive for future generations of Phil-Ams.
There's real story there about how conflicted they were and how conflicted Larry Itliong was. We're not trying to create a martyr here. We're trying to show you what happens to a leader within his community and how does he get out of what ultimately could be his downfall, which is the creation of the UFW, which is in a beautifully amazing moment for many leaders These beautiful milestones and these moments also enter you into a realm of superstardom. And then sometimes it takes you down a dark way.
Larry the Musical runs from March 16th to April 14th at the Brava Theater in San Francisco. For more details, visit LarryTheMusical.com. Rob McNamara, ABS-CBN News, San Francisco.
And before we go, the latest adventure of Godzilla and Kong features familiar faces, new villains, and a pint-sized but feisty mini Kong. Our Hollywood correspondent Yong Chavez gives us a look.
Super-sized battle sequences are featured prominently in Godzilla Kong, The New Empire, the latest team-up between two of the most powerful titans. The iconic characters dominate the screen with their might as they face new challenges that threaten every living thing on Earth. Kaylee Huttle returns as Gia, Kong's human friend. The young deaf actress was first introduced in Godzilla vs. Kong.
I think when I watch the movies, we don't realize how much work is actually involved in it. But now that I've been making movies, there's a lot of time that it takes to make the movies. You know, doing things over and over again, that takes a lot of patience to make the movies. But when I watch movies, you don't think that it takes a lot of time, but I realize it actually takes a lot more time than you think it does.
How did you realize that the acting is something that you wanted to do?
I didn't know if I wanted to be an actor, but I thought I would go for this role. And then when I got the second movie, I thought that was so cool. So we, of course, it's been such a great experience, and I'm very honored to be acting in such a big movie like this. But for the rest of my life, I don't know what I want to do. I'll have to see what I want to do.
Like other films in the MonsterVerse, the film used computer-generated imagery, or CGI, as well as practical elements to come up with the eye-popping battle scenes and lifelike visuals. Godzilla Kong, The New Empire was filmed mostly in Australia. Rebecca Hall reprises her role as Dr. Eileen Andrews, Gia's adoptive mother, who is learning to adapt amidst the changes faced by her daughter.
I really had a very enjoyable time on the first movie, and I haven't had a lot of experience of sort of revisiting a world that I sort of played in before, and it's a really fun experience to come back to something, because there is an element of almost nostalgia, because you sort of remember the things that you enjoyed about the last one, but you also have opportunities to build on it.
Family is also a subject that's important for Kong, especially when he meets a mini version of himself. The film's new character includes Brian Tyree Henry, Fala Chen, and Dan Stevens. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on our YouTube channel and on AT247 on Facebook. Keep well, keep it here on the news channel.
The health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to